Bioasteroid is an experiment to study whether we can use microorganisms, bacteria and fungi, to extract economically interesting elements from asteroid material. It's essentially what we would call a biomining experiment. And we hope to learn whether we can use microbes to extract things like rare earth elements and other elements that can be used to sustain a self-sustaining human presence throughout the solar system. In other words, mining in support of the long-term human exploration and settlement of space.
Bioasteroid is basically the natural following up of biorock. So why with biorock? We first investigated terrestrial rocks with three different types of bacteria. With bioasteroid, we are going to use real extraterrestrial rocks, that is going to be asteroid, of course, and two different types of microorganisms. One is a bacterium again, that was used already with biorock, and the second one is going to be a fungus, a penicillium fungus.
The biorock experiment demonstrated we were able to use bacteria to extract rare earth elements, which are used in your mobile phones and electronics, from basalt, which is an analog material for what much of the Moon and Mars is made of. And Bioasteroid is going to follow that up by saying, well, okay, now we can show that we can get rare earth elements out of basalt on the Moon and Mars. Can we do biomining on asteroids as well? So we're going to be looking at whether those microbes can get elements we'd really like to use in industry from the surface and interior of asteroids.
Experiments such as Bioasteroid and Bioasteroid that can really help developing a sustainable future of human space.
Here on the ground, if you go to a hospital or a clinic and you have a medical problem, like an infection, you often get a blood test called a white blood cell count and differential. That's a capability we don't have right now in spaceflight. So for exploration missions, when we want to go to the Moon and Mars, we are going to have to take our astronauts and make them more self-sufficient and more capable on their own. So our objective is to test out this device that can be used for clinical medicine in space so the astronauts can diagnose and treat their own medical problems. The device that we're using was developed on the ground under the gravity conditions of Earth. And what we are trying to do on the space station is demonstrate that it can still work in the absence of gravity. So as fluids move around within the machine and it does its blood analyzing work, we want to make sure those fluids move properly in the space environment. Our goal in this work is really to try and expand what we can do in spaceflight from a medical perspective, because when we send people to Mars and someone gets sick on the way to Mars, we have to be able to take care of them where they are instead of focusing on being able to get them back to Earth quickly.
We are sending brain organoids to the space station.
A brain organoid is a miniaturized version of developing human brain. So this really mimics the early stages of a human brain development.
Our first mission was to test if the brain organoids could actually survive into this microgravity environment. The second mission has two main goals. I mean, the first one is a validation of the first missions, but we are also adding a more mechanistic extrapolation or insight where we're going to be manipulating the telomerase activity inside these brain organoids.
These brain organoids, although they are human models, so they have a great potential to study human disorders, they are actually mimicking the very early stages of the human brain development. There is for us no way to do this type of research on Earth, so we would really need to go out there in space to see what's the impact of microgravity. Being able to perhaps accelerate these brain organoid maturation could help us make better human models for neurodegenerative disorders, for which for most of them we don't have any treatments or cures.
What makes me really excited about space is the possibility to improve disease models and the contribution to future human space travel missions or colonization in other planets. This might seem like science fiction, but I feel that the moment is really positive right now for this kind of research.
The study that we did about 5-6 years ago, we sent up iPSL-derived cardiomyocytes.
There's a few things that have made me gasp out loud up on board space station. Seeing the planet was one of them, but I gotta say, getting these cells in focus and watching heart cells actually beat has been another pretty big one.
For this particular study, we're going to go one step further to make it resemble more of a human heart, meaning that not just the cardiomyocytes, but we're sending it in a chunk of a human heart tissue that has the cardiomyocytes, the fibroblasts, and the endothelial cells. We put the three cells together to form what we call a 3D engineered heart tissues. And our plan is to send these contracting 3D engineered heart tissues up to space so that we can understand the effect of microgravity on cardiac function in human heart tissues.
This is the scaffold that holds the engineered heart tissues. So one scaffold contains four of these tissues when they are beating. If you think about it, the human evolution took place under the influence of this unseen force that is gravity. And if you take that fundamental force out, it is something that the cells have not experienced before. So there's a lot of challenges, and we are glad to be a part of a team that offers solutions at every step of the way that has made us to get to this point where we are confident that our science is going to push the frontiers of cardiovascular research to the next level.
Our research is devoted to the problem of resolving the damage that may be caused by micrometeorites and space debris on man-made objects in space. We are trying to understand whether we can use the old technology called brazing to execute the process in real time and in situ. But before we go into development of the technology, we have to understand the physics of the problem, and that understanding of the physics requires experimentation under both terrestrial and space microgravity conditions. We are building the experimental samples which are going to be delivered to the space station and then used in the equipment that is already in the space station. In parallel, we are repeating exactly the same set of experiments under terrestrial conditions, performing the same set of analyses, comparing the two, and concluding whether or not there are important differences related to the impact of gravity or not. We are trying to understand whether the same phenomenon that we observed under terrestrial conditions can take place under space conditions.
My name is Brock Howe. I'm project manager for the Nanorax airlock that you see before us. This is going to be the first commercial module for the International Space Station, designed and built here at Nanorax. We've been working on the airlock for about 5 years. It's going to be a new airlock to the space station, similar in use as the Japanese airlock, but this one's about 5 times the size of the Japanese airlock. The opportunities for scientists to do work and be creative with the airlock are a myriad of different ways. One of the primary things is deploying objects off of the space station. Nanorax does that on these small CubeSat type format right now. The airlock will provide a capability of much larger volumes of those type of payloads to be deployed out into space. We also have external payload mounts where we can host payloads on the airlock. We can also host payloads inside the airlock while it's still berthed through node 3. So there's a lot of different environments that the scientists can use, a lot of different volumes the scientists can use, a lot of different payload power and data capabilities on board the airlock that really will enhance their ability to do some really cool science on board ISS. The airlock also represents for Nanorax the next step towards our goals, which are commercial space stations. So this provides a lot of capabilities to enhance our engineering capabilities and our fabrication capabilities within our company to be able to get to those end goals of commercial space stations.